Welcome back, everybody. The last time we were together, I introduced you to the four-step hypothesis testing procedure. Now we're ready to go through our first example. And as we go through these examples, along the way, I'll start talking to you about some of these more detailed things, like the differences between one-tailed and two-tailed tests, the differences between type 1 and type 2 errors, how to compute effect size, and what statistical power is all about. Here's our first example. Let me change the views and then we'll work on it together. Let's read through it. On a depression inventory, the population mean equals 26 and the standard deviation equals 4 for the population of clinically depressed patients. We want to test the efficacy of a new treatment. We select a random sample of 16 patients. Right off the bat, I see this as a relatively small sample size. We will often use small sample sizes in our class examples, but I can tell that this is a somewhat underpowered study. What I mean by underpowered is we don't necessarily have a lot of evidence based on just 16 people to find statistically significant differences when they might exist. Regardless, let's read on. After treatment, the mean depression score is 25. So you see that's a sample mean, X bar. That sample mean comes from the 16 patients who have already been treated. Does the treatment have a significant effect on depression? Test with an alpha of 0.05 two-tailed. I mentioned that in many disciplines, the alpha level is already determined for us. That's what determines how much evidence we need to reject the null hypothesis. And I also mentioned, if theoretically your results can go in either direction, you should probably be doing a two-tailed test. And when it comes to a treatment for depression, theoretically speaking, the treatment could work and we can lower depression, but also theoretically speaking, that treatment could upset people and make them even worse. It makes a lot of sense to do a two-tailed test. Let's put into perspective what we're doing here. We can see untreated people have a depression score of 26. The 16 people who have been treated, they have an average depression score of 25. There's a difference. We want to make sense of that difference. There are two potential reasons for that difference. One reason is this treatment works. It lowers depression. Another reason for that difference is just sampling error. It could be that we're finding these differences just due to chance variation, and the treatment actually has no effect at all. By the time we get to step 4, we will draw a conclusion as to which one of those explanations is more likely. Let's start with step 1, where we state our hypotheses. There are two competing hypotheses, and we always state these hypotheses in terms of population parameters, mu. So I'm going to write those down initially. The first thing we're going to work on is our null hypothesis. The null hypothesis is the one that states no effect. This treatment doesn't work. If this treatment doesn't work, then the population mean depression score equals 26. Remember, the people who have not been treated, their average depression score is 26. To clarify which population mean I'm referring to, I'm going to use some subscripts. So in this case, mu, the population mean depression score for the treated people. So at this step, I always want to be as clear as I can. I ask myself, population mean what? What am I measuring? I'm measuring depression scores. And then I ask myself, for whom? Well, I'm trying to measure the population mean depression scores for the treated people, so I make that clear with my subscripts. The population mean depression score for these treated people under this null hypothesis equals 26. Now let's talk about the alternative hypothesis. The alternative hypothesis is a competing hypothesis, and it needs to include every other possibility. If the null hypothesis states that the population mean depression score for the treated people equals 26, then the alternative must be that the population mean depression score for the treated people is not equal to 26. The null hypothesis essentially states there's no effect. The treatment doesn't work. The alternative hypothesis states there is some type of an effect. It either lowers or increases depression. Let's move on to step 2. Step 2 is all about figuring out how much evidence we need to reject that null hypothesis. Because keep in mind, we will move along through these steps assuming that null hypothesis is true. In order to figure out how much evidence we need to reject that null hypothesis, we need to create a distribution of all possible sample means. We will create that distribution of all possible sample means based on these parameters from this parent population. So let's link those population parameters with our distribution of sample means. So this is a distribution of X bar, in other words, a distribution of sample means. And we're going to remind ourselves as well, we're creating it based on the idea that that null hypothesis is true. If that null hypothesis is true, most of the sample means that we will find will be equal to 26. And you might recall that according to central limit theorem, this distribution of sample means will be normally distributed and its mean will equal the mean from the parent population, 26. Right there on that line, we're going to be listing mean values. And right below it, just to make sure we don't mix them up, we're going to be listing z-scores. And we know that mean value of 26, because it's right in the middle, it would transform into a z-score of 0. We're just labeling up this distribution so that we know what we're working with. Keep in mind, there's some variability. And that variability is measured by the standard error of the mean. We're going to need to know the standard error of the mean when we transform our sample mean into a z-score, so let's just go ahead and compute it now. The standard error of the mean equals the population standard deviation divided by the square root of the sample size. The population standard deviation in this case equals 4, and the sample size equals 16. The square root of 16 is 4. 4 divided by 4 equals 1. So in this case, the standard error of the mean equals 1, which means on average, the sample means differ from the true population mean of 26 by about 1 point on that depression scale. All right, now that we've got our distribution labeled up reasonably well, let's do what we really need to do at step 2, and that's locate this critical region. We know exactly where those critical regions begin because we're using an alpha of 0.05 two-tailed. Let's look that up in our Z table and just remind ourselves of what those Z values are. Here's our Z distribution. If we need to use an alpha level of 0.05 for a two-tailed test, then we will have two critical regions, two rejection zones, and we need to take that 5% of the distribution and split it equally between those two tails. So 5% divided by 2 would be 2.5%. As we look down this column, the smaller portion, because we're trying to find an area in a tail, we want to look for 0.025. That would be 2.5%. So let's scroll down and take a look. We're going to have to go pretty deep into the distribution because there's really not much room left in the tail. And right there we see exactly 2.5%. And we're reminded that the z-scores that mark off those critical regions would be positive and negative 1.96. So that's what step 2 is all about, finding where those critical regions are. So I'm going to mark them off. I'm going to mark off one critical region on this side and mark that at 1.96. We're going to need a critical region on this side as well, and I'll mark that at negative 1.96. So now we know exactly where those critical regions begin. And keep in mind what those critical regions represent. They represent where we would find sample means that are unlikely to occur by chance. How unlikely? We would expect to find those sample means 5% of the time or less just due to sampling error. So when we say we're going to try to effectively rule out sampling error, that's how we will effectively rule out sampling error. If we find that our sample mean is in a critical region, we have effectively ruled out sampling error. But if our sample mean, that sample mean of 25, is not in the critical region, then we have not ruled out sampling error. Then our results are actually explained pretty well by sampling error. So now we're ready for step 3. We need to figure out where is this sample mean? Where is 25? Is 25 right around here, very close to that population mean of 26? Or is 25 over here, one of these sample means that is unlikely to occur by chance? Once we transform it into a z-score, we'll know exactly where it is. So let's do that. Let's put in our sample mean, 25. We're going to subtract that population mean of 26. This population mean right there is always the population mean that we note in our null hypothesis. So in our numerator, we have 25 minus 26. That represents the differences we actually see. And we're going to divide that by the standard error, which equals 1. And the standard error represents differences we would expect just by chance between sample means. So these tests that we do, this z-test in particular, is looking at differences over differences we expect by chance. In this case, we have a difference between groups of 1 point on that depression scale, and we want to divide that by 1. So that gives us a z-score of -1 overall. So that sample mean of 25 is 1 standard error below the mean. Now we need to locate that in this distribution. Here's -1.96. That's 1.96 standard errors below the mean. 1 standard error below the mean is somewhere right around here. So let's mark it off. We can put down that x bar, our sample mean, of 25 is right about there. You can see that our sample mean is not in the rejection zone. And that's what we need to figure out. Do we have enough evidence to reject our null hypothesis? The way I draw the conclusions in step 4 is by asking myself a series of questions. And then once we get the answers to all those questions, we'll revisit step 4 and we'll write it out a little bit more formally. The first question that we need to ask ourselves is our sample mean in the rejection zone? And clearly the answer is no. Now I'm going to ask 3 follow-up questions, and here's the good news. If that first answer was no, all the other answers are going to be no as well. That's going to help you more easily interpret your results at step 4. So that first question was, is our sample mean in the rejection zone? We said no. Follow-up question, should we reject the null hypothesis? No, we should not. And if we're not going to reject the null hypothesis, that means we're going to check it off. We're going to show that we're going to keep it. The terminology that statisticians use is that we will fail to reject the null hypothesis. That just means we're keeping the null hypothesis. We are retaining the null hypothesis. We still believe the null hypothesis is most true. The next follow-up question I ask is, do we have statistically significant results? No, we do not. So off to the side, I just put a little note, NS, non-significant. And then I ask myself, finally, is it possible that we're making a type 1 error in this situation? And again, the answer is no. You might recall that a type 1 error is when we conclude we have statistically significant results and we are wrong. It is impossible for us at this point to be making a type 1 error because we did not conclude that we have statistically significant results. So, long story short, we don't have enough evidence to conclude that this treatment statistically significantly lowers depression. In a minute, we will more formally write up our results in step 4. And all the information that we need is right here. We concluded that we have non-significant results, so we failed to reject the null hypothesis. We found a z-score of -1. There's one other thing that I like to handle at this point that's going to be helpful in a minute. When we write up our results, we write them up in a particular way. And at one point, we need to say something about the probability of finding our results just by chance. Let's remind ourselves that our sample mean was located right here, right at that sample mean of 25. It was in this large region right here. So the probability of finding it just by chance should be high. And we always list this probability in terms of the alpha level. Remember, our alpha level was 5%. So in this case, we are going to conclude that the probability is greater than 5%. That's going to alert everybody who's reading our research results that we did not find statistically significant results. If we found that our sample mean of 25 was in this small little region right here, then we would have rejected the null hypothesis. We would have concluded that we have statistically significant results. And then when we would write that up, we would write P, the probability of finding those results just by chance, is less than 5%. That takes a while to get that down. Students often confuse that. But there is indeed a very easy way to remember if we should be writing p less than 0.05 or p greater than 0.05. Remember that p represents probability, and probabilities are equal to proportion of area. Our sample mean in this case is in this large portion of area, so it should be associated with a large probability. What's large? A probability greater than 5% or a probability less than 5%? I'm sure you would agree that what is large is a probability that is greater than 5%. And that's how we will determine each time exactly how to write up our results. Let's go ahead and do that now at step 4. Let me change the views so you can see what I've already written. When we write up our results at step 4, there are pretty much four different things that I want us to get done. The first thing that we need to accomplish is let everybody know if we rejected or failed to reject the null hypothesis. And this is how I usually write it up. First of all, I provide a little context. I say that that sample mean, X bar, was not in the critical region. This mean is likely if the null hypothesis is true. Remember, all the sample means that we find in here, they're very likely to be found just by chance when the null hypothesis is true. And that's why we failed to reject the null hypothesis. The next thing we need to do as we write up our results is provide an explanation in everyday language. No statistical jargon. What did you find? What I have is a good example. It says there is insufficient evidence to conclude that the new treatment had a significant effect on depression. That's the type of everyday explanation that anybody could understand without having any statistical training. The third thing we need to do is list how this particular statistical test would be summarized in a journal article. In a journal article, there's no room to show all of your calculations and all of your graphs and things like that. People just want to see a summary of your results. And we summarize those results in a particular way. You'll get used to it as we go through a few examples. So here's the little statement that we're going to put in. The first part of it just shows the results of our Z test. It says Z equals negative 1. And that's because that's what we found. Z was equal to negative 1. Then we need to say something about the probability of finding that sample mean of 25 just by chance. And we concluded that there is a greater than 5% chance of finding that sample mean just due to sampling error. So we list P greater than 0.05. And then we just make it clear for everybody that that was based on a two-tailed test. The final thing that we do is compute a measurement of effect size. The reason why we include some measurement of effect size is because so far, the conclusion that we've drawn has just been a yes or no type of conclusion. We've concluded that we either do or do not have statistically significant results. By computing the effect size, we're sharing a somewhat more nuanced measure of how big the effect is that we actually found. Because keep this in mind, we did detect at least somewhat of an effect. The people who were treated had a sample mean of 25. That is different from 26. It's the type of difference we would expect just by chance, but nonetheless, there was a difference. And the way that we express that difference is using a standardized measure known as Cohen's D. Let's take a look at that formula. Cohen's D looks to see how big was the difference that you actually computed, and we found a difference between that sample mean and the population mean of about 1 point. So the difference that we have found divided by the standard deviation. So Cohen's D is a standardized effect size because it looks to see how big is the difference in terms of standard deviation units. You'll recall that sigma, the population standard deviation, is listed right here. And it shows 4 points on that scale. The standard deviation equals 4 points on that depression scale. So when we take -1 and we divide by 4, we find a Cohen's D value of -0.25. And that's a relatively small effect size. When effect sizes are small, it's often hard to find statistically significant results, particularly when our sample size is small. So in this case, it's possible that that treatment really does work, but we didn't have enough evidence to substantiate that. If that's the case, then we're making what we call a type 2 error. And type 2 errors exist in the legal system as well. Are there times when a guilty person is found innocent? Yes, sometimes we just don't have a strong enough case to convict guilty people. So there's a possibility, at least some possibility, that we're making a type 2 error in this situation. You can see there's a lot of information in that analysis, and to truly understand what's going on, we need to look at every little part and kind of put it together into one coherent story. You're going to get some experience doing that because we have 3 more examples. By the time we get finished with those other examples, you're going to be feeling really pretty good about this 4-step procedure. So I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.